Finance Minister Matia Kasaija, while presenting the budget for the next financial year, said government received $217 million to help aid small-scale women entrepreneurs in their business. Did the budget meet your expectations, or you're also just getting to terms with the allocations? Well, as a business person, regardless of how you feel, you must look out for opportunities in order to take home profit at the end of each day. Welcome to The Business Show. Here now are some of the stories that made the business week. Women to get $217 million to boost their business. Uganda's international reserves shoot up to $4.5 billion. IRA licenses 20th bank assurance provider. President Samia banks on historic ties to woo investors in Omani, and Sri Lanka gives government workers extra day off a week. Welcome to the show. In recent weeks, the debate has been on whether government should waiver some taxes in order to help the skyrocketing prices as Ugandans continue to complain, and these reactions have been deemed fit by some reasonable number of people. However, the Permanent Secretary and Secretary to the Treasury, Ramadan Gobi, says these are based on emotions and not facts. So this week, in News from the Top, he tells us what government is working on to help the situation, but also what you, on an individual level, can do to reduce your expenditure in these unprecedented times.
Inflation and the proposal from some of our economists that maybe we should, it's time to rethink the weight of fuel vis-a-vis other commodities.
You see, economics should be informed by evidence and facts, not by opinions and emotions. You know, in Uganda we have one problem. People don't want to follow diagnosis. Someone wants to come up and say, in my opinion, this is what should be done. Your opinion is not scientific. Now, we have a Uganda Bureau of Statistics, which collects data every year. In the latest statistical abstract, Uganda Bureau of Statistics shows us that Ugandans are spending most of their income, about 40.6% on food. Food. That is followed by housing, energy, and the other utilities, about 17%. When you come to these other things people think should take the precedence, they are very small components. So food is the key item Ugandans spend on money. And because of that, food was allocated a higher weight when we are computing our consumer price index. Because that's where the consumer's preference is. That if you gave a Ugandan 1,000 shillings is likely to put aside over 400 shillings for only food. That's the food ratio. Other items, individually, they are getting below 170 shillings. And that's why you realize that whenever the food prices rise, the cost of living increases very fast. And it becomes very difficult for Ugandans to survive on their income. Other factors or other components of their expenditure may actually see the prices rising, but when people are not so much affected, because they can substitute them. You can't easily substitute food. Like recently, cooking oil saw the prices rise. but the inflation was not rising so fast until fuel came in. Fuel is among the utilities I was talking about, the energy and the utilities. It is the second after food in the weight, with housing combined. When the cooking oil prices increased by nearly 87% year on year, the inflation of Uganda did not change. Why? Because cooking oil has a very low weight in someone's basket. Many Ugandans don't eat even cooking oil. Others who are eating it can easily substitute it or can reduce the rations. But you can't easily substitute food. Food is food. Therefore, although we are not downplaying the significance of oil products, especially petroleum and diesel, because they are the ones which power the economy, transport of these goods, even food. Food is transported. So when fuel prices rise, the food prices may easily also increase somewhat. But if food is not in a shortage of food, then the prices will not rise so significantly. So I don't support the idea of changing the weight. Anyway, I don't even have the powers to change it. It's about the facts. If the data is showing you that this is where the people are spending more in the basket of goods that they purchase, then you allocate the relatively higher weight. And that's what Lubos is doing.
Okay. Still on the issue of fuel, Kenyan election is coming up, and yes, we normally see what happens during their elections. There's chaos that disrupts our supply chains for fuel, actually. How prepared are we in case things go bad in Kenya?
Yes, we've been working on alternatives. We already analyzed this risk, profiled the risks we are likely to face, not only the Kenyan election, but also the international geopolitical challenges we are having. But in particular, for the forthcoming election, which has usually historically been affecting us, if it goes, quite chaotic, we are looking at the option of evacuating our oil using other routes, the southern route to Tanzania. And the government has already been in advanced stages of preparing the logistics of getting our oil, especially via Lake Victoria, and other products which are of significance, evacuated to Uganda. So we have alternative routes we are preparing. But also we are working on stocking some fuel along the way, so that we are not very much constrained. But also we are hopeful that this time the election will be good. Younger people who were not in the old Uganda, to understand where that old Uganda came from. In the old Uganda, many people thought that the best way to manage the economy is to control things when prices start to rise. Number one, don't allow fuel prices to rise. So government administered the prices. In those budgets, national budgets, they used to announce that from midnight, the following are the prices. Fuel, like now, if President Museveni was president of those days, of other presidents who led Uganda, would announce that, okay, for fuel, it's going to be 4,000 a liter. And in that, the state was required either to invest in the bringing the oil itself or subsidizing the produce, I mean, those who are engaged in selling of fuel. Now, subsidy is when government picks money from the treasury and gives to the private sector so that they can reduce the cost of doing business and the private sector sells at a certain price. In that case, that means you must have the money in the treasury to pay to the private sector. And where does government get the money? From taxes. But remember, the source of the money, you have said, cut it. Cut the tax. That's what the president was calling suicidal. You are like strangling yourself. At one hand, you want to support the producers and suppliers to supply a commodity at a lower price. And at the other side, you want to get that money to support them. And yet to get that money, you need to tax. And to tax would bring a certain markup on the price. So what the government used to do then was either to borrow that money or to print it. Now, in most cases, nobody wants to lend, wants to lend you money when you are using it that way. They would cut their lending because they are not sure whether you will be able to pay back. Your economics is looking very questionable. And since you can't borrow, now you resort to printing money. But printing money is inflationary. When you print more money, you give it to the people will demand the good whose supply has reduced. And what happens? The prices will rise again. And you lose control over the situation. That's how economies collapse. And that's how Ugandan economy actually collapsed. Before the year 1987. This very government you see in power today tried that economics for 1 year in 1986. They realized it can't work. And they instituted the reforms, what we call economic recovery program of 1987. From that time, they learned a lesson of number one, leaving the prices to find their level. Right now, the fuel prices have increased. When the fuel prices increase, the people who can afford the fuel reduce. Those who are selling the fuel sometimes even want to cheat, what they call cheating, because they want to use the situation to put in some markup to make money. But they forget that as you raise the price, the buyers will reduce in the number and the volumes. Someone who used to put in a full tank now puts in 100,000. And it drops himself forward. He's no longer dropping people around. Now, with the reduced demand of fuel, the prices are going to get a downward force, pulling them down. That's why we are saying this is a temporary problem. And as that demand force pulls it down, the people who want to this high price want to supply more fuel. Like the president was explaining, there are some of our neighbors who issued the subsidies and also some who are controlling the prices. Some of them have already faced shortages of fuel. Why? Because the dealers in fuel in those countries now want to bring the fuel to Uganda. Now, at the end of the day, you'll find the prices of fuel in Uganda reducing because of increased supply. That's why we are saying Ugandans that we are not just failing to do something, that we are seated here and say, let us wait and God intervenes. No, we are actually applying economics of not interfering with a certain force which is pushing the supply up of fuel because of the good price now, and a downward force pushing the demand down because of the high price. So at the end of the day, you find a certain price which will now stabilize the fuel. So I would want to emphasize what the president said, that within no time, this temporary pain is going to go. But you don't deal with the pain by adding in more fuel. If we encourage the Ugandans to buy more fuel, which is already expensive globally, because now this is not a Ugandan problem. Everywhere in the world, fuel prices have gone up. And governments everywhere, they are trying to see how to get fuel continue to be supplied. That's the first major responsibility of government, to ensure that these fuel tankers don't dry up. Because if they dry up, then we shall be in a crisis.
I had asked for tips on how to live amid this environment.
The first tip is number one, draw up. Now, redraw, because there was a budget. Redraw your budget and ensure that the first call on that budget are the necessities. The necessities of life. Food is number one. And that's why for people in urban areas like here in Kampala, that should be the critical item, food. Because the prices of each and everything has gone up. Then after food, get something else which is so critical. And reduce on these other items, which we can do without. In other words, get cheaper substitutes for each and every item that we buy. This is the life, by the way, which we live, all of us. Somebody may see Ramadan now is talking, he's secretary to the treasury. Does he do that? Absolutely, yes. You will not find me going to the expensive restaurant, sit down to eat a meal which can feed the entire family.
Indeed, as you've noticed, the views of the Permanent Secretary and Secretary to the Treasury are not different from what you've been dealing with. But one thing is for sure, always spend within your means or even below your means. Spend on needs and not wants. That will take us into a short break. We shall be back shortly, but the business show has so much more lined up for you.
Like 20 to 50 grams, and then first I cited 15 people who could be potential customers from different groups, from the elite working class and the normal. And then I gave 15 people. And everyone was like, wow, what a product. What is missing is only the packaging. But we've never tested any pure ginger ever. I was like,